Can you imagine your state government telling you or your pastor what you can and cannot pray for? It sounds too weird for words. Yet that's exactly what the Pride activists have achieved in the Australian state of Victoria. Professionals and religious leaders can no longer counsel their clients or parishioners or even pray for them to overcome their unwanted same-sex attraction. Sounds too Orwellian to be true, right? Couldn't happen in a Western democracy, right? Don't take my word for it. Here's what their website says. Quote, prayers that are directed at a person to change or suppress their sexual orientation or gender identity cause harm and are prohibited. These could include prayers that ask for healing, ask for a person to change, ask for a person not to act on their attractions, talk about a person's brokenness or need to repent, or ask for long-term celibacy, close quote. But wait, what about consent? That's the linchpin of the entire sexual revolution, right? So if somebody wants to change, gives their pastor consent to counsel them about it, that would be okay, right? Nope, they've even got that covered. Their frequently asked questions page says this, quote, someone has come to you who wants to change or suppress their sexual orientation or gender identity. Why can't you help them? And the answer is, someone may be willing to change or suppress their sexual orientation or gender identity. However, this willingness is heavily influenced by a desire to be accepted, whole, and worthy, which comes from a deep identification with that person's faith. There is no scientific evidence that sexual orientation or gender identity can be changed or suppressed. Any activity to encourage this person to change or suppress their sexual orientation or gender identity will cause harm, close quote. That is a pretty sweeping statement. Even a single counterexample is enough to disprove it. Always, everywhere, never. Are you kidding me? And we at the Ruth Institute have more than a few counterexamples. We know these sweeping statements like this are simply not true. We've got powerful testimonies from people like Paul Darrow and Charlene Cothran, both of whom left the LGBT subculture years ago and are doing fine. Or Walt Heyer and Chloe Cole, who both struggle with gender dysphoria, attempted to transition, and then detransition back to their birth sex. Now they speak out about their experiences to let others know that they can change too. Stand with us as we protect the defectors like Paul, Charlene, Walt, Chloe, and so many others who have left the LGBT subculture. Your generous support enables us to share their stories with audiences around the world. Your support also helps us to promote the findings of our research associate, sociologist Father Paul Sullins. Father Sullins showed that talk therapy to address unwanted same-sex attraction does not hurt people. Using data collected by the gay lobby itself, Father Sullins found that therapy does help some individuals to change the intensity of their same-sex attraction and helps their mental health in many other ways. Your financial support can go a long way toward helping us get the word out. Helping even one confused soul is worth it to us. What is it worth to you? I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse for the Ruth Institute. Thanks for watching. Remember back in the day when gay marriage was still considered a debatable issue? Do you remember how some of us said, they're going to be teaching school children about gay marriage? And the gay lobby said, no, you're being hysterical, that'll never happen. And if it did happen, it'd be okay because kids should really know something about a perfectly legal marriage arrangement. Do you remember that? Did you think then that we'd be seeing transgenderism taught to preschoolers? When we said, you know, this is going to affect religious people and religious institutions. Did you think then that we'd see Catholic hospitals being told they have to do transgender surgeries? I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, founder and president of the Ruth Institute. My guest on today's episode of the Dr. J Show is John Bursch. John is an attorney with the Alliance Defending Freedom. He's argued 12 cases before the U.S. Supreme Court, and we're going to talk about our experiences defending traditional Christian teaching on marriage and family from our separate perspectives. He, as an attorney defending marriage in the courts, and me as a campaign spokeswoman for California's winning Proposition 8. Not just reminiscing, we're going to be talking about strategies for moving forward in today's increasingly hostile environment. And of course, we'll be talking about his new book, Loving God's Children, the Church and Gender Ideology. John Bursch, thank you so much for being my guest on today's episode of the Dr. J Show.
My pleasure. Very happy to be here.
Well, that's great. So listen, you have written a very interesting book called Loving God's Children, the Church and Gender Ideology. What is this book about, and why did you choose this particular title?
Well, the work that I do at Alliance Defending Freedom, in addition to focusing on life issues, is heavily involved in religious liberty and free speech. And in the aftermath of Obergefell, and I know this is something that we'll be talking about, the left immediately pivoted to add the T to the LGB, and all of a sudden these transgender issues were everywhere. And so in the free speech and religious liberty space, I found that in the last several years, about 95% of my docket has been consumed by gender ideology type cases. It started with, it's incredible.
Well, so 95%?
Yes. So it started with the boys who identified as girls so that they could be in the locker room or the restroom or the shower in high schools. And then it quickly moved into athletics. And you had women like our clients in Connecticut, four brave girls, and they lost 15 state track and field titles to two boys who identify as girls. Then after that, it moved into the pronouns, and employees at work were losing their jobs or being demoted or suffering other repercussions because they wouldn't use preferred pronouns and lie about the reality of someone's sex. And then from there, it moved even more insidiously into schools. And as you mentioned, they introduced curriculum where they were asking kids as young as kindergarten to identify their gender. And then it got worse, and they started to develop plans where they could transition kids at school while keeping it a secret from their parents at home. And now even today, in places like California, parents of their own natural children can lose their parental rights for abuse and neglect if they decline to affirm their child's transgender identity, which was pushed on them at school. And so in all these contexts, everywhere from employment to hiring to free speech, you name it, that the hospital was another good example. It was just consuming everything. And so I had obviously spent a lot of time thinking about the legal issues, a lot of time studying the science so that I could in court talk forcefully and truthfully about how trans medicine is harmful to people with gender dysphoria and things like that. But it was important to me as well that I understood the Catholic Church's theology about the human body and sexuality. And so I wanted to dive deeply into that. And as I did, I discovered things in Pope Francis' encyclicals and public statements, lots of wonderful documents published by U.S. bishops. And so I started to put all that together, and I thought, people need to know this. And so I wrote a book that you don't have to have a law degree or a science degree or a theology degree to understand. It's very straightforward and plain, but it gives parents and grandparents the information they need so they can talk winsomely and truthfully to their children and grandchildren about these issues and try to prevent them from falling into the cultural trap of transgenderism. And if they can do that, then they can also have those same conversations with their neighbors and their friends and even their coworkers. And we can start to stem the tide against what has really been an insidious and very harmful social movement.
Well, this is very interesting. And I read the book, and I didn't expect exactly the answer that you gave me here, you know, because it didn't register how rapidly your docket changed, right? And that is a huge indicator of just of the trajectory of the whole thing. You know, I mean, I think a lot of people have been surprised, like, oh my gosh, this stuff is everywhere. It's on TV, it's on the kids' cartoons and all this stuff. But you're seeing it from the perspective of an attorney. All of a sudden, you've got all these cases that simply weren't there before.
Exactly.
So, right. And so the book that you've given, we have a picture of it right over here. It's up on my shelf. You've got it behind you, too. This is a very helpful document for people, just as you said, to dig more deeply into it. So you basically, in the past couple of years, you've had to become an expert on all of this stuff. Is that what it amounts to, John?
It's really remarkable. You know, I remember the very first case. It was a cert petition that we filed with the Supreme Court. As you know, those are the documents where you ask the Supreme Court to take a case, and they ultimately turned it down. But it involved a case where they had a bathroom, locker room, shower assignment at a public high school based on gender identity rather than sex. And I just couldn't believe that that was happening. And then as I dug into it, I realized that it was happening all over the country. And then very rapidly in quick succession, all these other things started to follow along. And in almost every case, it's not culture that's causing the legal problems, it's government, whether it's state and local government or the national government. Exactly. Because it's not enough just to allow people to work out the situation on their own at the local level. The government has to step in and demand that you do this, that you bend your knee at the orthodoxy, or otherwise you'll be suspended from school, you'll be kicked off the athletic team, you'll lose your federal funding, you'll be sued for employment discrimination. They have so many levers of power to get people to do what they want. And that's why it makes it so dangerous. And it was only really in the last 6 or so months where I started to see a really strong, maybe 6 to 12, concerted effort by conservatives to not only talk publicly about these things, but to pass some of their own laws to protect kids from these dangers. You know, and so we're seeing Save Women's Sports laws now adopted all across the country in more than 20 states. And more than a dozen states have adopted these laws that prohibit the use of puberty blockers and cross-sex hormones and surgery for minors who are struggling with gender dysphoria. So we're just starting to see a beachhead go in the opposite direction. But without a full-fledged nationwide effort of people who are knowledgeable about the issue, speaking up to their representatives, we're going to have trouble making as much headway as we need, because the cultural media, Hollywood, social media app influence is so strong.
I want to pause right there on this point, because there are many people now who are opposed to transgenderism who had no problem with gay marriage. And I've been trying to talk to those people a little bit, you know, to say, I get it. I get what you're trying to do, but I don't really think that's going to be possible. I really think that there's a way in which gay marriage paved the way for all of this. And you saw it in your docket, you know, you saw the immediate consequence of it. So I want to
if I could tell a story. I argued Obergefell in 2015. I argued Obergefell in 2015.
I didn't know you argued it. You were the guy in the, oh my gosh, celebrity. People.
Yeah, Ruthies. I was hired by Michigan to argue that case.
I see.
And so when the opinion came out in June, you know, obviously it was very discouraging. But if you watch the media, the attention on the opinion and, you know, the national celebration over same-sex marriage was actually quite short-lived, because pretty much all of us knew that Justice Kennedy was going to be the fifth vote to create a constitutional right for something that doesn't appear anywhere in the Constitution. You know, we could have a long conversation about how, you know, illicit and illegal that opinion was. But within a matter of weeks, the media attention shifted. And it's because they had already lined up Bruce Jenner to come out as Caitlyn Jenner. And they were pushing celebrities like I Am Jazz. That was the young boy who identified as a girl. And they made a cable television show out of it and then produced kids' books, which quickly went into the schools. And so the left, anticipating the decision, was ready to move the culture quickly to the T portion of the LGBT. You know, it was not even months. It was just a matter of weeks. And they were already saying, this is just like same-sex marriage. This is another example where people are being discriminated against because of who they are. And, you know, the question was never raised by anyone in the broad media. Well, is an embrace of this ideology good for the kids who are suffering from gender dysphoria? What kind of impact is this going to have on other kids in schools? What's this going to do to families? You know, what are the long-term ramifications of telling people that their bodies are irrelevant and they can manipulate them however they want, based on the grossest stereotypes about what they think it feels like to be male or female or both or neither or something else altogether? And so the culture, and I'm talking here specifically about the media, the Democratic Party and Hollywood, we're ready to tack on that T immediately starting in July of 2015. And that's why things moved so quickly. It just became part of that bandwagon.
This is so interesting to me for a number of reasons. Okay. The one that I just mentioned, you know, those of you who thought gay marriage was a fine thing, you just wanted to help your gay nephew or your lesbian coworker. They were ready to move to the T. Okay. So I want y'all to just kind of think about that. All right. But the other point I want to make is that in my book, The Sexual State, which I wrote in 2018, after fighting all, you know, being involved in all the marriage wars and stuff, the whole point of the sexual state is that the sexual revolution from the beginning has been a creature of the state. But in transgenderism, you can really see it. You can really see it happens so fast and in such a calculated manner. There's simply no question that this was some kind of cultural movement that just kind of swept through history, you know, some kind of abstract, you know, force of history or something, a force of nature. No, this is a calculated plan by the elites to change the society in which everyone lives. And they have their reasons. We could talk about that. But the point is for people to just understand, the sexual revolution has been this type of elite top-down con job from the beginning. That's my considered opinion. And now you can see it. You know, now it's clear. It should be clear to everybody at this point. So,
well, and the Supreme Court has taken a leading role in that. You know, you go all the way back to Griswold, you know, which predates Roe versus Wade. And it struck down a law that required contraception to only be distributed to married couples. And the idea was to prevent out-of-wedlock births, because if you have non-married people engaging in sexual relations, the natural result of that is going to be babies. And the state does have a strong interest in making sure that every child is bonded together with their biological mom and dad to the extent that's possible. Obviously, it's not in 100% of the cases, but you know that's the government interest, to keep kids bound to their parents. Well, as soon as the Supreme Court helps separate sex from marriage, then all of a sudden you saw an explosion in divorce rates, an explosion in abortion, a subtle drop in marriage rates, you know, and then all of a sudden all of these out of wedlock births, you know, and the Supreme Court helped push that along. And then in Roe, they pushed it farther because they created a right to abortion that didn't exist in the Constitution. And so now all of a sudden there was a backstop. If contraception didn't work, you could take the life of your child.
Right.
And then we come along with gay marriage, and you know, there was a political movement for that, but it hadn't made it very far. You know, Prop 8 was one of many, many, many successful state constitutional amendments that defined marriage between one man and one woman. And the Supreme Court wiped all of those away. And now here we are with the government still pushing this stuff. And the Supreme Court did it again in the Bostock case just 2 years ago, where they redefined sex discrimination in Title VII. That's the law that governs employment discrimination for all the employers in the country, you know, of a minimum size, and said that sex discrimination includes discrimination based on sexual orientation or gender identity. And now what you see are government officials arguing at every level of the court system that same reasoning has to be applied to Title IX and women's athletics and privacy spaces and to medical statutes that require people not to be discriminated against based on their sex in hospitals or insurance coverage. So, you know, unfortunately, the Supreme Court, part of the government, has had a helping hand in all of this as it happens. Now, to their credit, in recent years, they've been very robust on religious liberty and free speech. And so that's where we're putting a lot of our efforts right now. But the problem is, when you push the culture like this, even with those religious liberty and free speech protections, is that people get hurt. It hurts the women
that's
athletes.
Right.
It hurts the people in the workplace. But most of all, it hurts those who have gender dysphoria, because when they go down this path, inevitably, it's inviting a lifetime of hardship and medical problems. I mean, just to tick off a few of the ones that I discuss at length in the book, the best long-term studies that we have are from the UK, Finland, Sweden, Denmark. And the reason why it's those countries is because they were the leaders in so-called gender-affirming care. They're the ones that started prescribing puberty blockers and cross-sex hormones and surgery for younger and younger people. Well, they have the long-term studies now that the United States does not. And what those long-term studies show is horrifying. It shows that people who go through that transition, they may have a short-term bump in their mental health, but over the long haul, they have higher incidences of suicide, higher mental health issues across the board, problems with brain development, bone density, heart problems, permanent infertility, permanent loss of sexual function, and even a reduction in life expectancy, as much as half. And so to say that this is the loving, supporting thing to do is the exact opposite of what science tells us, that going through transition is one of the most medically, physically, emotionally harmful things that any person can do. And so it's really criminal the way that federal, state, and local officials are pushing this agenda.
And I want to go back to one thing you said kind of in passing, because I want to underline this point, that sometimes there's a short-term bump in people's feelings of well-being after they either start the hormones or do the surgeries or what have you, but long-term things fall apart. The reason I think this is important to emphasize, and I want you to say a little bit more about it, is that in some of the families who are dealing with directly this issue directly, they may draw the wrong conclusion from what they're seeing in their loved one. You know, their daughter starts taking testosterone and she feels better. Well, golly, testosterone makes you feel energetic and euphoric up to a certain point. But that's not the whole story. So John, draw that out just a little bit. Tell us more about that short-term bump and then the long-term problems that follow.
Sure. Well, first to explain why, despite any short-term bump, we shouldn't expect a better long-term outcome. And that's because even if you go through all of it, you've done all the treatment possible and you've even had your sexual organs mutilated and reformed into something that they were not. You've done all of that. Every single cell in your body is still coded male or female. Any biochemist could take a sample from you and look, and they would be able to tell that you were male or female without looking at whether you had facial hair or what your body parts look like or the clothes that you wore or the bathroom that you used. So it's creating a natural conflict between what your body is trying to be and what you're professing it to be. So, you know, that step number one is problematic, and we shouldn't be surprised when something like that doesn't work. The other thing is that often with gender dysphoria, there are underlying mental health problems. Some studies have said that as many as 60% of those individuals, and now we're not talking about the more recent trend where, like, kind of as a social contagion, large numbers of girls, you know, a dozen of them in a seventh grade class will all declare themselves to be transgender at the same time. So, you know, leave that aside. That's a separate problem. But for people who have clinically diagnosed gender dysphoria, some studies say as many as 60% of them suffered from sexual abuse as children. And so if you're just giving them the drugs and giving them the surgery, you're not dealing with any of the underlying problems that cause the mental health issue. And so we need to do that. So when you don't do that, yes, in the short term, drugs or, you know, what seems like a fix can be helpful. And so the University of Michigan came out with a study just in the last couple of months, and they said, you know, look, we had people come to our gender clinic and they all feel better. Well, in that study, it all looked at people who had been less than 5 years removed from whatever intervention the gender care clinic gave them. When we're looking at these countries overseas, they're looking at, you know, 10, 20, 30 year time periods to see what happens to folks. And over time, what they see is it's getting worse. And so any little bump is not going to be a long-term solution because it doesn't actually change what the body is telling everybody it is. It doesn't actually deal with the underlying mental health issues. All it does is put a bandaid on the problem until all of a sudden that person realizes, wait a minute, this wasn't such a good idea after all. And we're hearing now from more detransitioners. This is the group of people who first transitioned, you know, maybe even including surgery, and then realized they made a mistake and had harmed themselves and then tried to came back. We just hear so much regret because they can't get their bodies back. You know, if you're a woman and once you've had your breasts removed, you can't ever nurse a baby. Some of them have permanent loss of sexual function even after they've transitioned back to their natal sex. And the thing that you hear from them over and over when you listen to their stories is that no one told them that there was any other path than to take the drugs and to undergo the surgery. They didn't get offered the counseling that they needed. They were simply told, oh, you're trans. I've got a magic pill that will be the solution to your problem. And so, you know, what haunts me not only as a lawyer, but as a person, and should haunt anybody who doesn't study this issue and hasn't thought about it, you know, is to have that friend or relative who transitions and then detransitions and says, why didn't you tell me?
Right.
If only someone had told me that this was going to be the result, I would have handled this completely different.
That's why
it's so important that people be educated about the issue, especially the science, but, you know, all of it from soup to nuts. And they communicate that to their family members and other loved ones, because if we don't, they're going to be severely harmed.
You know, we interviewed Chloe Cole not too long ago, and I'm sure you're familiar with Chloe Cole's case. She's suing Kaiser for exactly this business, you know, of rushing her through and not giving her alternatives. And she described in some detail the way in which they psychologically manipulated her parents, you know, because her parents were doing what the doctors told them. But the most heartbreaking moment in that interview for me, it literally broke my heart. You know, I asked her, what made you think that this was a mistake? You know, what what made you rethink this? And she said, well, in my senior high school class studying psychology, we learned about Harry Harlow's monkeys and how the baby monkeys would cling to their mommies no matter what and how much they attached to their mommies. And we learned how important nursing is. And I said, I want to do that. I want to nurse a baby. And she realized that she couldn't. I mean, John, what are we doing to society where a teenage girl has to be surprised by the thought that nursing a baby would be a wonderful experience? You know, I mean, what is wrong with it? I mean, this is a rhetorical question.
Yeah. Well,
but honestly, you know, what is wrong with us?
It's heartbreaking because we don't allow teenagers before age 18 to vote. We don't allow them to undertake any surgery. They couldn't have their tonsils out or their appendix removed without parental permission. Yeah. You know, certainly if they were 7 years old and they said, now I'm a horse, we wouldn't give them medicine and surgery to make them look like a horse. You know, children have all kinds of ideas in their head. They're not mature enough to understand the long-term ramifications about something as serious as changing their sex, as though that were even possible. You know, and so it's criminal that we would allow educators and counselors and doctors to do this to them. And what's horrific is what happened to her parents. You know, they understand that she's having severe mental health distress. Any loving parent wants to do something to relieve that. The doctors say, well, do you want to have, you know, a dead child of this sex or a live child of the opposite sex? You know, that's the lie that they tell. And then they say, well, of course, I want to keep my child alive. So, you know, I have to do this. And they feel pressured, not realizing that they're condemning their child to a lifetime of physical, mental, emotional problems, and one that's more likely to result in a suicide death than
right.
if they didn't give them any treatment at all. And the flip side of that coin, too, is that so many of these kids, if they weren't pressured by their peers, by their teachers, by the doctors, would just naturally work things out. The best
oh,
studies
yes.
that we
yes.
have, 80 to 95% of adolescents who are struggling or dealing with this trans dysphoria of some sort will naturally align their mind with their body if left to their own devices. But if we start affirming them by allowing them to dress as the opposite sex, to use the bathroom, to take the pills, to use the preferred pronouns, I mean, that's like the gateway drug to this is the preferred pronouns. If we do that, we're condemning them to a lifetime of hardship. And people need to know that.
John, I want to ask your opinion now. I didn't expect to ask you this question when I was planning this interview, but now that we've gone down this path, and by the way, the book is called Loving God's Children, The Church and Gender Ideology. We haven't even begun to talk about the church, but I want to ask you this question. What do you think these people are after?
Well, I think there's lots of different motivations. So let me call out a couple of categories and then maybe suggest an overarching theme for why this movement has happened, which I won't tie to any individual person, but just kind of the tidal wave of the culture. So, you
That's
know, for
right.
the doctors, there's a ton of money involved. If you get to a surgery, you're talking about, you know, $70,000 in many cases. And Planned Parenthood now, one of their biggest revenue streams after abortions is gender care, the puberty blockers and the cross-sex hormones. So for the medical profession, there's a lot of money in it. And some political pressure too, because in these large organizations like the American Medical Association, which continue to push for these kinds of you know, really dangerous and harmful interventions, they could know better. They could look at these studies overseas and see
yeah.
what the actual science says, but they won't even let discussion happen among their membership. Whenever anybody raises a proposal to study the issue further, they immediately shut it down because they've been politicized and they don't want to have those conversations. So that's the medical community. Then you look at parents. And if you're a parent and you allowed your child to go through a transition, how could you ever publicly acknowledge that you made a mistake, that you allowed someone to take away your child's sexuality and their bodily and mental health? I mean, at that point, once you've allowed it to happen, you're going to be permanently vested to defend the movement, even when it seems absurd and extreme and contrary to science and common sense, because to acknowledge that you were wrong would be to acknowledge that you did a terrible, terrible act of abuse on your child. And so I think they're kind of locked into this. Then you've got a whole nother group, and you know, these are the adolescents who are actually engaged in the transition. Well, why are they pressing it? Well, because it's really hard to go through puberty and to grow up as a teenager. I've never met a person, adult or teenager, who didn't during those years feel times where they were anxious, where they weren't comfortable in their body, where they had difficulty making relationships, where they just felt uncomfortable about who they are. You know, those are all things that we naturally experience as part of that. And now all of a sudden you've got these social groups propping up those who take on a trans identity. They're the most popular kids in school. They have friends everywhere. Yep. They're all told, you know, so they have a whole social thing. So maybe those are some possible motivations of different interest groups. Now, how about the movement as a whole? Well, this is really the near end, and I say near because it's not the end, but the near end of the sexual revolution, going all the way back to the 1960s, where the idea was that, you know, God's laws or even natural laws that controlled our conduct don't apply to us, and that we're free to chart whatever course we want for ourselves. So I can have sex without consequences, even though one of the two main purposes of sex is to have babies. You can just remove that from the equation entirely because we're humans and we're in control of this. Nature and God aren't in control of this. When it comes to marriage, you know, the only kind of marriage that makes sense from a natural law, common sense point of view is one where you've got complementariness, because otherwise your reproductive system is not one that is even usable. It only works if you've got a man and a woman coming together in a permanent marriage where they can create and rear children. But, you know, we know better. We're human beings. We can take the marriage institution and define it however we want it to be, whether that's two men, two women, or four men and four women. And so now we reach the point where it's our bodies. And, you know, we all understand internally that we've got this soul. But instead of recognizing that we're embodied souls, and so the sex nature of our body says something about who we are, we say, oh no, the body's just a shell. I can manipulate it to be whatever sex I want because nature and God aren't in control. I'm in control. And the final step of this is not going to be transgender. It's going to be transhumanism, where we're taking, you know, metal parts and computer pieces and things like that and putting them in our body. And all of this is an attempt for the individual to play God. Because they want to be able to take control of every aspect of their life, not recognizing that we've all been designed in a particular way, and that if we don't follow that design, just like if we don't follow the blueprint in the glove compartment, that manual for our car, you know, the car will break down if you don't change the tires and change the oil. When we start to just refashion ourselves in our own image rather than in the image that we were created, then we're gonna break down and we're gonna have difficulty, which is exactly what happens with these surgeries. So I think it's that desire to have, you know, self-fulfillment and self-destiny that drives people to do this. And that's the same human condition that has driven almost every sinful act that humankind has committed going back as long as we've existed for millennia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, going all the way back to Adam and Eve.
All the way back.
God's laws don't apply to me. It'll be okay.
I know better.
Yeah, I know better. Did God really say that? So your list looks a lot like mine, but I would add one thing. In addition to this personal autonomy, there is also, I think, an element of power, just people who enjoy lording it over other people. And yes. The simplest way I can say this is that if you can make people say Bruce Jenner is a woman, you can make them say anything. And I think there are people in our world who get a buzz out of that. I mean, I think we've seen increasing evidence of that. And even the petty things, like what words you use, right? The idea that I can monitor people's speech in every corner of society, that's a real buzz for some people, for the wrong kind of person, you know?
Yeah, you're absolutely right about that. And we saw that in many places during COVID, but particularly here in Michigan, you know, where we had a governor who really put police tape on the gardening aisles at Home Depot and other places where you could buy seeds and dirt and fertilizer to prevent people from going outside in their gardens, who told people they couldn't take their boats out and then asked to have her boat out, who told people they couldn't travel out of state to visit sick relatives and then went to Texas so that she could do that, who told people they couldn't go on spring break trips to other states and then allowed her chief of staff to go to Florida. It was all about the power trip. And yet somehow the voters in Michigan reelected her.
Yeah, yeah. Money, sex, and power. Those seem to be the big three things that drive a lot of our toxic ideologies that we're dealing with. So, you know what, John, we've come to kind of the halfway point in our time together. And I want to just say that the next part of our discussion is going to be about religion and politics. And so we're going to take the rest of this over to our locals channel. So all of you who have watched this far and you want to know our strategies going forward, because that's what we're going to deal with next. Some of our strategies for what we're going to do next, we're leaving YouTube. I don't want YouTube listening in, okay? We're going over, you're going to go over to our locals channel. We'll see you over there in just a moment.